Hi, my name is Jeroen Lapre. I'm the Senior Technical Director in the Visualization Studio at the California Academy of Sciences.
And I'm Erik Krumrey, Technical Director and Data Visualizer in the Visualization Studio at the California Academy of Sciences. I'm looking forward to walking you through how we've used Houdini in our latest production, Living Worlds, The Search Begins.
The California Academy of Sciences is located in the Golden Gate Park in San Francisco. Its mission is to regenerate the natural world through science, learning, and collaboration. Part of that is an all-digital planetarium called the Morrison Planetarium. We have 8 planetarium shows that we produced in-house. Some of them we play on-site at the Academy. Some we have distributed worldwide to planetariums elsewhere. The advantage of an all-digital planetarium is that we're able to create the more traditional astronomy shows, but we're also able to create earth science shows as well. We hope to reach the audience on a visceral level, on an emotional level, and then we slip in the science. So in Living Worlds, we explore how life and its host planet co-evolve. Then we introduce to the audience the idea of how light from our sun hits our earth. Some of it's absorbed, some of it's reflected, and that becomes what's called a signature, like a spectral signature. And we build a conceptual ladder through the show as we reach beyond our Earth in the search of life in our solar system and in the galaxy. We then explain to the audience that our space telescopes have discovered over 5,000 exoplanets orbiting other stars, and how we can study the light bouncing off those exoplanets and look for those spectral signatures of life. And if we switch to the radio frequency, we may even detect technosignatures, evidence of galactic civilizations. So one of the things that attracted us to Houdini over the years is its procedural approach to doing computer graphics. We find that this lends itself well to science visualization. We're always impressed at how Houdini is able to ingest large amounts of data, science data. We've tried other 3D applications and then they would start to creak and groan on an amount of data that Houdini would eat for breakfast. So one of the milestone applications of Houdini in Living Worlds was the rendering of the star background. We used a 3D star catalog called Hipparchos, which contains the three-dimensional coordinates of 117,000 stars and their spectral information. We import that into Houdini, and then we're able to render them in 3D. So when we're flying from Earth to another star system, you see the other stars moving past the camera with the correct parallax. So one of the destinations in our show, In the Search of Life, is an icy moon called Enceladus that orbits Saturn. And so we used Houdini to create this world, which included the texture maps that were derived from the Cassini mission, where lots of images were taken of the surface. One of our data providers, Paul Schenk, stitched them all together and created this beautiful texture map that we used. He also provided digital elevation maps of these structures at the South Pole called Tiger Stripes. And we were also able to import them into Houdini and apply them to this icy moon. At the South Pole of Enceladus are these jets of ice crystals called the ice geysers. And their jets and position and angles are based on a science paper by Carolyn Porco. And we used volumetric particle simulations, fluid sims for that. And then we also visit the bottom of the subsurface ocean where there's a rocky core, and they believe that it's covered with these hydrothermal vents, the origin of these organic molecules that they are detecting in these ice geysers. So for that, we used fluid sims for the hydrothermal vents. In the search of life in our solar system, JPL are proposing a mission where they send a robotic spacecraft to Enceladus, which includes a robot called Eels, which is this snake-like robot which will be deposited on the surface and will snake its way down into one of these cracks in the ice, and then swim through this subsurface ocean in search for alien life. JPL were very generous in sharing assets with us, which included the 3D model and rigging of the Eels robot. Our animation supervisor, Ken Ackerman, was able to import that into Houdini and bring it to life. Erik worked on the look development of the surface of this robot. And one interesting factoid is that JPL liked our color scheme so much that it might end up on the actual mission if it were to be greenlit.
For Living Worlds, I was tasked with visualizing two gas giant planets, exoplanets located far beyond our solar system. We knew from the beginning that we would be getting some data from our scientists, but we didn't know the nature or detailed level of what that data would be. So we had to figure out how to balance creative, artistic creation of the look of the planets with the data that we were going to be getting. In the end, we got planet-wide wind fields at fairly low resolution from simulations these scientists ran, sometimes specifically for us, and used Houdini's flip solver to add procedural detail to the planets to get the resolution we needed to show on our 4K planetarium. One of the more interesting challenges that I personally faced with Houdini in doing the show was the flip simulations of the atmospheric winds. We were simulating on a flat 2D grid, latitude and longitude, but because of the nature of these planets, winds, matter, moves over the North Pole and comes down on the other side. But we couldn't initially do that with the flip sim because of the boundaries on the grid. And if we created periodic boundary conditions, winds would go over the North Pole and come on the South Pole. So what we had to do is create a larger simulation area and mirror the boundaries, the North Pole, South Pole, and East and West boundaries, and then crop out the results when we were done. That allowed us to achieve the results we wanted of matter flowing over the poles and appearing properly on the other side of the planet.
So one of the last remaining tasks that we had on Living Worlds was to create a 3D procedural star, because one of the exoplanets that we visit that Erik worked on is orbiting so close to its star that we actually see how big it is and we can actually see surface details. So we hired our Houdini consultant Jeremy Joswick on this production to work on this asset, and we had science advice from Doug Welsh on star properties such as size, temperature, color temperature. So this informed Jeremy on how to scientifically accurately create the surface details such as the granular structures and the star spots and the solar prominences, which are these huge arcing structures that grow out of the surface of the star, and he used VDBs for that. So the great thing about this asset is it fed two birds with one scone. It helped us finish this production, but it also helped kick off our next production, which will all be about stars. We are currently working on our ninth planetarium production. The working title is Nucleosynthesis. We will show how the elements that make up our bodies are formed when stars explode. These events are called supernova, high energy cosmic events. Our level 2 technical director, Matt Blackwell, will be leading this production. He's interested in using Houdini to visualize these events. In the meantime, I'll be working on combining the Hipparchus star catalog with this massive star catalog called Gaia. It contains over 1 billion stars. Matt has ported his beloved fisheye lens shader from Mantra, which we've relied on for all these productions over these years, to Karma. We're looking forward to incorporating Solaris and Karma into our pipeline and into our workflow.